Good morning. Welcome to St. Patrick Cathedral. We're glad to have you with us today. If you have a cell phone or other electronic device, please silence it or turn it off. This will help us to celebrate the Holy Mass without distractions. Please adhere to social distancing regulations, maintaining at least 3 feet between each family unit while seated in the pews and during Holy Communion. Today we celebrate the 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time. This Mass is offered for the repose of the soul of Mark Rigsby. The readings can be found at number 1170 in the red hymnal. That's number 1170. And our celebrant for this Mass is Father John Robert. Please join in singing our processional hymn, number 720, The Kingdom of God, number 720. Please rise.
Name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, gathering as God's holy people on this Sunday, let us call to mind our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate worthily these sacred mysteries of faith.
Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Together we say, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
And let us be seated to listen to the word of God proclaimed in the sacred scriptures.
A A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered together all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, summoning their elders, their leaders, their judges, and their officers. When they stood in ranks before God, Joshua addressed all the people. If it does not please you to serve the Lord, decide today whom you will serve. The gods your fathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose country you are now dwelling. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. But the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord for the service of other gods. For it was the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up out of the land of Egypt, out of the state of slavery. He performed those great miracles before our very eyes and protected us along our entire journey and among the peoples through whom we passed. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, be subordinate to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives should be subordinate to their husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of his wife, just as Christ is head of the church, as he himself the Savior of the body. As the church is subordinate to Christ, so wives should be subordinate to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and handed himself over for her to sanctify her, cleansing her by the bath of water with the word, that he might present himself to the church in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So also husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one hates his own flesh, but rather nourishes and cherishes it, even as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Many of Jesus' disciples who were listening said, "This saying is hard. Who can accept it?" Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, "Does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe." Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by my Father." As a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. Jesus then said to the 12, "Do you also want to leave?" Simon Peter answered him,
Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Language of commitment and promise to covenantal relationship permeates the readings for this Sunday. Joshua, in the first reading, spells it out succinctly to the people what he is going to do. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. The gathered community, in response, also makes their own affirmation. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. Of course, you and I know that the people's committed service to the Lord over time will ebb and flow. They are not always that committed, but at least now they want to be. Paul, in the second reading from the letter to the Ephesians, lays out a covenantal mystery to describe the relationship of Christ to the church, using the imagery drawn from the spousal relationship between husband and wife. He does this to highlight a point that should be a distinguishing feature of the Christian community: loving service to one another. In the language of Ephesians, be subordinate to one another out of reverence for Christ. As wife is to husband and husband is to wife, so Christ is to the church and the church is to Christ. And by extension, the people should be to one another, subordinating themselves to one another. The word subordinate, or subordinate in its verbal form, is fascinating. For those of you with a linguistic or grammatical background, it is used to describe a clause of a sentence that is not the main clause. In fact, given the properties of a subordinate clause, it cannot stand or exist on its own, but always must be connected to the main clause to which it is subordinated and related. Think of the main clause as Christ and the subordinate clause as the church. The members who make up the church are also subordinate to one another. We, you and I, stand in a fundamental relationship of subordination to our brothers and sisters who make up the community. We are in covenantal relationship to them, never apart from them. Another Pauline letter puts it this way in its magnificent introduction to the hymn that describes the self-emptying, or the Greek term, the kenotic love of Christ. In the letter to the Philippians, one reads, "Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vain glory. Rather, humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also everyone for the interests of others." Simon Peter, in the covenantal language reminiscent of the Caesarea Philippi event captured in the Synoptic Gospels, when he confesses Jesus as the Christ, commits and promises to Jesus today in our gospel passage from John, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." He has discerned through Jesus' long bread of life discourse that comprises the sixth chapter of John's gospel, in which we have been privileged to hear these last few weeks in the liturgy, that Jesus is the main clause to which he and the other disciples are subordinated, related to intimately. He knows he can't exist apart from Jesus. And like the people of Israel in our reading from the book of Joshua, Simon Peter gives voice to commitment and promise. Yet, you and I, of course, know that a few chapters later in the gospel story, he will deny that he even knows who Jesus is. So he, too, is not always that committed, but at least now he wants to be. The same is true for all of us. We, too, like the people of Israel, given the choice that Joshua offers, and also like Simon Peter, given the choice that Jesus presents, we, too, want to commit and promise wholeheartedly. To whom else shall we go? Acknowledging that Jesus has the words of eternal life. Yet we often fail. And fail miserably at it, like the people of Israel and like Simon Peter. Perhaps another biblical character may represent us. The father of the possessed son in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9. In that passage, when a father of a possessed child comes to Jesus seeking his help after the inability of the disciples to take care of the situation, the father, crying out to Jesus, gives voice to his, to Israel's, to the disciples, and to our seemingly paradoxical reality at one and the same time. I believe, help my unbelief. I believe, help my unbelief. We and our household want to serve the Lord, but we often serve other idols and gods, which are anything other than the Lord God himself. We want to believe that there is no other one to whom we shall go, yet we often do deviate. We want to say with Peter that Jesus alone has the words of eternal life, yet we listen far too often to other voices. We do believe, help our unbelief. In the daily liturgies of the church this past Friday and yesterday, Saturday, we had proclaimed in the first reading parts of the short story of perhaps my most favorite book in the Old Testament, the book of Ruth. A little gem of a story that highlights commitment, promise, fidelity, and covenant. Sadly, the story of Ruth never makes it into the lectionary for Sundays in the liturgical year. It is read at the two daily masses that I just named. In this delightful, wondrous, and powerful tale, a most unlikely candidate for covenantal love is presented in the person of Ruth, who is a stranger, an outsider to the community of Israel. She is a member of the hated and enemy Moabites, after all. But who nevertheless promises her widowed mother-in-law, Naomi, her steadfast loyalty and fidelity, that great Hebrew word, chesed. Ruth knows the one whom she serves. She knows the one to whom she will go. She knows the one who has the words of eternal life. She does believe. In one of the greatest passages in the Bible, and indeed in world literature, as she pledges herself to her mother-in-law, she commits herself to the journey of life and faith that leads to none other than God alone. Appropriately, her outpouring of covenantal love is worthy of wondering attendance and deep reflection for us. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people are my people. Your God is my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. And may God do thus and so to me, and even more, if even death separates me from you. the language of commitment and promise overflow in our readings today, but they overflow in the Bible and in our lives in sundry ways. May we be ever moving on the journey toward a faith as steadfast and unadulterated as Ruth's, even while at the same time we may be uttering with that lonely parent who encountered Jesus in the midst of great trial and desperation, of which our lives can be so filled, "I do believe, help my unbelief." My brothers and sisters, let us stand and together profess our common faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Having been nourished by the word of God with trust and faithfulness, let us bring our needs now before the Lord.
For the church, that we will find nourishment and sustenance in Christ, the bread of life, for our daily journey and the fulfillment for all the hungers and yearnings of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the ability to imitate Christ, that we may put on the mind and heart of Christ and be empowered to show compassion and forgiveness to others. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace to forgive, that having experienced God's generous forgiveness to us, we may be free to forgive all who have wronged us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of Afghanistan, that God will preserve them from bloodshed, open passageways for those who have cooperated with Western nations, and fill hearts with hope in their darkest moments. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of Haiti, that God will protect them from further harm, give them strength, and open the hearts of many to assist them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the perseverance and formation of our seminarians, and for vocations to the priesthood and religious life, that Christ may strengthen those who are discerning to follow him in a priestly and a religious vocation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For relief from the COVID-19 coronavirus, that God will guide researchers to a better understanding of the virus, so that the human family may be protected and that the sick may be restored to wholeness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died. That they may share in the fullness of eternal life to which the bread of life introduced them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the many intentions that the bishop offers normally at this Mass, those who have asked for prayers, in particular also for those suffering from the effects of the hurricane in the Northeast, we pray to the Lord. God of justice and compassion, you hear the cries of all people in need. Hear our prayers that we might selflessly care for our brothers and sisters and so work to bring about your kingdom of love and of peace. We ask this through Christ, our Lord. And let us be seated for the preparation of the altar during the liturgy of the Eucharist and the collection.
Please join in singing our offertory hymn, number 705, O Jesus, Joy of Loving Hearts, number 705.
And sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church, through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy, for you are the one God, living and true, existing before all ages and abiding for all eternity, dwelling in unapproachable light. Yet you, who alone are good, the source of life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so in your presence are countless hosts of angels who serve you day and night, and gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. With them we, too, confess your name in exaltation, giving voice to every creature under heaven as we acclaim. once in wisdom and in love you formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death. For you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again, you offered them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time, you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior. Made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. And to the sorrowful of heart, joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death. And rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may the same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for the celebration of this great mystery which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. To you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope Michael, our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. The act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things. I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Singing our communion hymn number 945, Taste and See, number 945.
Oh,
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us, so that in all things we may please you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Today's special collection will be for the Religious Formation Department here at St. Patrick. Thank you for your generosity. Each year, the diocese assigns each parish a mission to support. This year, we will support the Kumbani Missionary Sisters with a special collection on August 29th, next Sunday. More information about their mission can be found in the bulletin. RCIA has begun meeting at 7 p.m. on Wednesday evenings in the parish hall. More information can be found on the church website as well as the church bulletin. The Handbell Choir will begin rehearsals in September. This group is open to all adults as well as teenagers in the 9th through 12th grades. If interested, please contact Carla Gonzalez or Aaron Medina, and additional information can be found in the bulletin. St. Patrick will welcome the choirs back to 8 a.m. and 11 a.m. Masses in September. If you are interested in participating in the choirs, please contact Aaron Medina, Director of Music and Liturgy. Father John Roberts' classes will meet tomorrow, Monday, as well as on Tuesday, August 23rd and 24th. Monday's study will feature Sunday's upcoming readings. Tuesday's study will examine the Gospel of John.
And with your spirit, bow down for the blessing.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May he let his face shine upon you and show you his mercy.
Amen.
May he turn his countenance towards you and give you his peace.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing our recessional hymn, number 773, The Summons, number 773.